Listening on the line, watching online, everybody looking beautiful this morning in the auditorium to the end of our missions convention this morning as I close out with a special message called the Junkyard Connection. Now, how many of you had a chance to go to a connection group this week and hear a missionary? Raise your hand. Yeah, wasn't that awesome? Yeah, I mean, I heard nothing but great reports. Is we had missionaries on Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday night, and all different connection groups. And it's a great to hear their stories. And then yesterday we had the missions banquet at Silver Shores in Wyandotte. That was a powerful drama that we saw, a presentation of a missionary's life. And then this morning is kind of the grand finale where we'll be taking faith promises at the end of our gathering here this morning. Now, in America, we are a consuming country, right? We are a consuming country. Whether we're consuming electronics, whether we're consuming cable or Netflix, whether we're consuming our favorite Tim Hortons or Dunkin' Donuts or Starbucks, whatever it is, right? We're a consuming country. Matter of fact, in 2013, the statistics from the Consumer Bureau report was that about 7% of our income is given to strictly consuming for our wants and our desires. And that's not anything new to us because we're pretty familiar, hopefully, where our finances go. If not, we have a group called Financial Peace University you can sign up for. So because of this consuming tendency, the experts try to get us to invest our money because investing is better than consuming, right? You get a better return when you invest. Matter of fact, if you just took $1,000 and put it somewhere in a fund that got 5% interest for 20 years, it would more than double. It would be about $2,500-something from just putting in there and investing your money. So investing always gives a better return than consuming. But yet there's this constant battle of tension between us because we like to consume, right? We want to get it. And I don't know if you ever had this thought before, though. Consuming is a challenge because sometimes we don't even know what we consume it on. Have you ever had this question before that came into your mind? Where did my tax return money go? Right? Or where did that profit share or that bonus go? Like, I thought we had more money than that. We just had it. I don't even know where it went, right? Because we find ourselves consuming. And there's nothing wrong with all these different things. But the reality is when we consume and consume and consume, it often leaves us just with the desire just to consume more. And it doesn't often produce the things that we want it to produce. Like, I know growing up, I loved bowling. And bowling was my life. And I have a plaque here, 94, 95. That was a good year. That was a good year. It was an okay high series, 657, nothing to be impressed about. But high game of 264, okay, I guess. But I won that year for that. And I had a whole slew of these things that were all over my room. I had a shelf full of trophies. And they were very important to me. And, they were everything to me. I mean, I lived for the Saturday bowling. I listened to Eye of the Tiger in my ear, got pumped up, got ready for bowling. And yet now, here I am at 37, and I have a whole box of trophies and plaques that I probably should just throw away because they've been sitting in storage for, full of dust, and I'm probably never going to open them ever again. And so it's just so funny because something that was so, that I spent so much time and energy and thinking, and it was my life, is now just collecting dust, right? Or I remember when somebody gifted me a tablet. I had someone gifted me a Surface Pro 3, and I bought one of those nice screen protectors that are military grade, so that you get it's supposed to bounce and not break and all this other stuff. Well, but I dropped it before I put it on. It's like, yeah, that didn't work out so good. Or just even the other day, we had a leak in one of our pipes, and we always have these storage bins, but this one didn't have a top on it, and the leak went right into this stuff, and it had all this memorabilia stuff for our children when they were kids, and even Julie had some stuff when she was from high school, and some of the stuff she tried to save, but she had to throw it away, right? And we find ourselves going, wow, we spent a lot of time, a lot of energy, a lot of resources, a lot of money, a lot of passion, a lot of thinking, a lot of things, on things that are going to fade, are going to end up in the junkyard. And the reason why this message is called the Junkyard Connection is because you and I have a strong connection to the junkyard, because the majority of the things that are so important to us now, one day, are going to end up in the junkyard. I mean, I live by the junkyard. I live on 11th Street here in Wyandotte, and I go by the junkyard all the time. And there's been stuff that's been there 6 years and it hasn't gone anywhere. And it's sitting there, and I bet you that there's things in there that at one point were extremely important to people. Like, it was valuable to them. They probably sacrificed for it. They probably gave for it. They probably, who knows what for it. And now it's just sitting there rusting and just waiting there, you know, for someone to make a little bit of money on. So that's why it's the junkyard connection. But you know what? Is there a way to invest that our lives would actually matter and have an impact beyond our time on this earth? Because if there is, that's what I want for my life, right? Can we learn to invest in things that won't end up in the junkyard, like this Dodge thing right here? If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. If you're not familiar with the Bible has two sections, Old Testament and New Testament. And Matthew is easy to find. It's the first book in the New Testament right away. The verses will be on the screen, or we encourage everyone to download a really, really slick, free Bible app for any device called YouVersion. You could track along with this. Matthew chapter 6, verse 6. And we're going to look at this junkyard connection. And then we're going to see that the things that we often spend our time and our money on eventually going to end up there. And we're going to see that there's really only one way to beat the junkyard connection. And Jesus actually speaks to us, teaches us, and gives us the vision of how to beat the junkyard connection. Every week at Wyandotte Family Church, we have a slogan that's a main theme throughout the entire message. And so if you can repeat this with me this morning, this one's short, but say, invest in what will outlast. Invest in what will outlast. Now, this portion of scripture is extremely interesting because the person who wrote the book of Matthew was Matthew, right? Shocker. He's a scholar. Matthew wrote the book of Matthew, but here's the thing. He was a tax collector. And so before he was following Jesus and really, you know, became all in, I mean, he was all about money. And money was everything to him. I mean, he extorted people for money. He took advantage of people. He did all sorts of things. And so it's probably most likely money was his God. Money was what ruled his life. Money was what he lived for. And so it's very interesting that you now have this guy who was so consumed with money is now penning and writing the teachings of Jesus, particularly about money. And this particular verse that we're about to read, and a couple of verses we're about to read, is sandwiched between, right in the middle of Jesus' famous Sermon on the Mount. Now, he has this teaching that's called Sermon on the Mount. It starts with the Beatitudes. I don't know if you ever heard it, but blessed are the poor in spirit, for they will inherit the kingdom of heaven, or blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted, right? And he goes through that, and that's called the Beatitudes. And then he goes into teaching about the fulfilling the law, and he talks about, you know, anger and murder, and he talks about lust and adultery, talks about divorce, and then he gets to money. And this is where we're going to pick up, and because Jesus talked a lot about possessions and a lot about money. And here, he's going to be challenging us to invest in what will outlast. So Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 says this, "Don't store up treasures here on earth where they can be eaten by moths and get rusty, and where thieves can break in and steal." Matthew 6, 19. Now, the first point, if you're taking notes on the back of your communicator, is this, is earthly investments will always fade. Earthly investments will always fade. Now, the stuff on earth that we see is the stuff that we're tempted to barter our eternal destiny for. Because the enemy of our souls wants us to live our lives for things that are only temporary. Things that are going to fade, things that are going to get rusty, things that are going to get thrown away. And so we find ourselves living for, hey, what's the next outfit that I can get? Or what's the next car I can purchase? What's the next house that I can buy? What's the next, you know, whatever, fill in the blank. And we find ourselves, you know, being consumed with temporary things, being, you know, because the enemy of our soul wants to do this. And I wrote this morning on Facebook. The enemy of our soul wants us to spend our time and our energy and resources on things that will not last. He wants us to consume more than we contribute. The devil, the enemy of our soul, wants us to spend our money and not send our money. That's what he wants us to do. And Jesus says, man, earthly investments will always fade. You see, in that day and age when Jesus was talking to those Jewish people, is they had something called strong boxes. And what a strong box was something where they put, you know, their treasure in, and they would bury it in their house. Because, you know, they didn't have carpet or hardwood floors like you have. You know, they had dirt, and they would bury it in their house and protect their treasure. However, though, things, you know, got rusted, coins got rusted, you know, thieves would break in and steal. And so Jesus is saying, hey, don't store up things in your strong boxes where thieves can break in and steal and moths can come and destroy and all this other stuff. He says, don't do that because earthly investments won't last. And so you and I don't have strong boxes, I don't think. Nobody has treasures buried under their house. But have you looked? You never know. You should check. I'm sorry. Get distracted. But even though we don't have strong boxes, we still face the same temptation. And we have a tough reality that the things that we invest in, guess what, guys? They're going to eventually. That Xbox 360 or 460 or 560, I don't know where they're at right now. But whatever they have, you know, that's going to get broken. You know what? The latest car is going to get the ding from that person who doesn't pay attention when they open their car door, right? All the latest clothes are going to eventually not fit anymore. Woo! All these things that we so invest in are going to fade. They're not going to last. You know what? There's this amazing story about this journal, American tourist that went to see this Polish rabbi. And he sat down with the Polish rabbi, and he was kind of taken back that all that he had in the room was a little table and some books and a chair. And he said, you know, yes, rabbi, where's your furniture? And the rabbi replied back to him. He said, well, where's yours? And the American kind of laughed, and he said, well, that's silly. I'm just a visitor. And he said, so am I. See, Matthew 6:19 says, if we invest on this earth, it will eventually decay. It will get stolen, it will get old, it will get broken, it will fall apart. You know, and even groups of nations that have found treasures, when they either bury them and lose them, or they've been stolen and fought over, you know, and wars have broken out, and Jesus is saying there's no safe investment on this planet. There's no guarantee on this planet. Invest and what will outlast. So point number one is earthly investments will always fade. But number two is this. Jesus goes on to say eternal investments will always flourish. The opposite. One will fade. Eternal investments will always flourish. Look at Matthew 6:20, just the next verse. It says this. Store your treasures in heaven where they will never become moth-eaten. They'll never become rusty. And they'll be safe from thieves. No one's going to bust into heaven, you know, and take what you've invested there. And he was saying, invest in eternal matters. It cannot be stolen, it cannot be broken, it cannot be taken. And this could be the hardest thing for us to do. Because you might be thinking, okay, Jesus, if you want me to store up in eternal things, how do I do that? Right? I mean, there's not like a Heavenly Home Credit Union in Wyandotte. I can just roll up and they roll down my window and say, whoop, there you go, you know. So how do you invest in eternal things? Well, I think first of all, every time you invest in your relationship with God, you're investing in eternal things. Every time you pray, every time you have enough guts to open the Bible on your own outside of a Sunday morning, every time you begin to come to church and to worship with other people, every time you're investing in eternal things, things that cannot be taken away from you. But also, not only that, I think every time you invest in people, because people are the only thing that are going to live forever. You know, these new chairs that we're buying, one day there's going to be a whole other congregation that's going to go, we need to buy new chairs. Look at these black chairs. You know what? We need purple and green chairs. let's have a chair campaign. Woo, right? And they're eventually going to fade. They're eventually going to go. And it's the people that matter. People are what are going to live forever. And so every time you invest in people, you are investing in eternal things. Every time you pray for someone, every time you're listening to someone, every time you're sharing your faith with someone, every time, you know, you're there for someone, you know, every time you give to missions so people that don't know Jesus could come to a relationship with Jesus is eternal things. And Jesus says those kind of things will last forever. No thief can steal, no moth can eat, and no rust can even touch. Wow. You know, this quote I thought was so powerful. It says, if you read history, you will find that the Christians who did the most in this world were just those who thought most of the next. Understanding that this is not our final destination. And if we invest everything here and now, we will be extremely disappointed that we didn't invest more in our permanent home. And I also like this quote too. Do your giving while you're living so you're knowing where it's going. I thought that was cute too. So Jesus is trying to teach us in verse 20 that what we give away, we keep. And what we keep, we ultimately lose. And so if you say, man, I really, you know, I don't want to lose, you know what? You know, Jesus also said that spiritually, you know, what is, you know what? You could, if you try to keep your life, but you're going to lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake, you're going to find it. It's like when we trust God and say, I'm going to live my life for eternal investments, then you're actually going to gain. Wow. Invest in what will outlast. Point number one, earthly investments will always fade. Eternal investments will always flourish. Point number three, if you're taking notes, investments always reveal our hearts. Always. There was a missionary, David Livingstone, who he spent his time in Africa. And when he died, his body was buried in England, but his heart actually was buried in Africa. And the natives literally took his heart and they dug a hole and they buried it there because that's where he gave his life. And my question to you would be is, if they were going to bury your heart with what was most important to you, where would they bury it? Where would they bury it? I pray that it would be buried in some way, shape, or form with trying to take as many people into heaven with you. Reach as many people. Look, Matthew 26:21, Jesus says, wherever your treasure is, there your heart and your thoughts will be also. Jesus is saying, wherever your treasure is, there your heart will be also. And so we have to ask ourselves the question, is where is our treasure? Because that is where our heart is going to be. Or if you want to ask it in a different way, is if your God doesn't have your treasure, then he doesn't have your heart. Wherever your treasure is, there your heart and your thoughts will be also. And we know it's true because how many times, anybody in the room ever has bought a brand new car for the first time and just in your life? Bought a new car, yeah. Now what happens when you buy a new car? All of a sudden you become a Nazi. You know what? You know, you're like, don't touch that window! You know, and you're like watching everything. You park, you know, and I know I've taught this before in my sermon in the past. Like, you know, it's always a fun exercise. Whenever you go to Lowe's or Home Depot, Walmart, and that person's parked way out there with that nice car, go park by them. Just for fun, you know, and then just they come out, they're like, what? There's someone parked by me, right? Because it's a new car, right? And you don't want anybody dinging it. You don't want a shopping cart, you know, rogue shopping cart just flowing through by the wind and hitting your car and you're getting mad at your kids, right? And why? Because your heart and your thoughts follow your treasure. And wherever your treasure is where your heart and your thoughts follow. And so if you want God to be front and center, then put your treasure in your relationship with God. And your heart and your thoughts will follow. And that's why Jesus even instituted the tithe, because that's the ultimate final surrender of trust with your treasure to him. That, hey, I am all in with you, God. I'm going to obey. Wow. So if your hearts follow what we treasure, the question we have to wrestle with is, does God have our treasure? And the amazing thing is that this passage of Scripture wasn't being preached to Americans. Jesus wasn't sharing this to me, you know, who, you know, loves to go to Tim Hortons and eat number one breakfast combo and enjoy free Wi-Fi. All right? He was talking to Jews who were being oppressed by the Roman government. He was talking to Jews who money wasn't about going to MJR to watch a movie. Money was about survival. They needed every penny they can get. A lot of these Jews didn't know, because the Romans were taking advantage of them, taxing them extra. It was intense, and so it wasn't they had an abundance of money. But Jesus was telling them, hey, if you want, you know, to really be all in, then wherever your treasure is, there your heart and your thoughts will be also. So if that applied to them for survival, how much more does that apply to us? Invest in what will outlast. Number one, earthly investments will fade. Number two, eternal investments will always flourish. Number three, investments always reveal our heart. Number four, we're getting close to the end. In order to invest properly, we need God to change our perspective. This is interesting. I don't know if you know, we always have perspective on finances. I mean, remember as a kid, your perspective on finances? It was like when you had money, it was off to the store. I still grew up in the day and age where there was like, you know, the 5 cent, you know, candy shops, and you know, and you could just wait to go and ride your bike to the store and get all your candy. And then you kind of, you know, I remember my dad one time, you know, he'd give us an allowance as kids, and I remember he went to my brother's piggy bank, and it was full of money. He went to mine, and it was empty. He's like, what happened? He's like, I give you guys the same amount of money, so what did you do with the money? And I was like, I don't know. I gave some away, candy. We have different perspectives on money, you know, as kids. And then we grow up as teenagers, and you get to college, and then money is like an evil necessity because you have to spend a whole lot of money to hopefully make some money. And so you find yourself spending a lot of money. Then we become adults, right, and we have our own perspective on money. And whenever we get to a message like this, we think, yeah, Jeremy, this is a great message for a Sunday morning, and it feels good in church, but then I get out of here into the real world where there's bills and there's children and there's gas in the car and there's, you know, all this stuff, and you're like, it's not as easy as you make it think, Jeremy. But I want to challenge you this morning to change your perspective, change your thinking. I know some people say, Jeremy, you're doing building fund pledges and mission pledges, and I haven't even tithed yet. You're like, slow down, woo, you know, pull back the reins there. But, you know, and I understand that, but these are natural responses, I think, because this is the way that we've been trained in this culture to think. Is we are perfectly performing the way that we've been trained to think according to the American mindset, not the kingdom of God. We've been trained according to culture standard, not God's standard. And so it can seem foreign, it can seem awkward, but I'm going to tell you, God always says, just taste and see. You know, taste and see. So look at Matthew 6:22. And this is a portion of scripture that I'm excited to share with you here, because historically, most people don't ever communicate this in the context of giving. And I had Mike Nagel help me with some research to make sure that I wasn't off base, and he did a great job of helping me. I'm going to share some of the thoughts that he gave me. And here's the thing is these two verses fit, unless Jesus had ADD, and he was like preaching about money and saying, where your treasure is, there your heart is also. And hey, oh, by the way, you know, over here, oh, back to money, right? Now, so unless he did that, this all fits together in context and talks about money. So I want you to look at these two verses. Your eye is a lamp that provides light for your body. When your eye is good, your whole body is filled with light. But when your eye is bad, your whole body is filled with darkness. If the light you think you have is actually darkness, how deep that darkness is. So when you look at the Greek here in this passage of scripture, it's not just talking about the physical eye. You know, when we read eye, it's not just talking about the physical part of our eye, but the way that we think and the way that we perceive and look at something. And how we behold something. And if we have the right perspective and thoughts about something, then it affects everything else. But if we have the wrong or dark perspective about something, it literally will keep us from seeing what is right in front of us. We're going to miss out. You know, in the book, I want you to listen to this, The Gospel According to Matthew. Listen to what Morris says. This is so powerful. He says, if a man divides his interest and tries to focus on both God and possessions, he has no clear vision. And he will live without clear orientation or direction. Life not focused on God's claim and command is lost in spiritual darkness. Wow. So he's saying, listen, guys, if you look at money from a different perspective, what I'm teaching you here right now, you know what? Don't store treasures on earth. Store treasures in heaven. Wherever your treasure is, where your heart and thoughts will be also. And then this is where he comes to these two verses right here. It says, if you look at it through any other perspective, you are going to bump into things that you're going to regret. And I think, how many of you ever bumped into something in darkness before? Yeah, yeah. I do it all the time. I don't know why I haven't learned. You know, whenever with Julie and I fold laundry and we're done and the kids are sleeping, we don't want to go into their room, right? So we put the laundry basket in the hallway. And I'm always the first person to get up in the morning, and so the alarm goes off and I'm trying to wake up, and without fail, like, bam! You know, you kick the laundry basket with your bare toe and you're like, oh! You know, trying to be quiet and you're hopping around, you know, the hallway, you know, and trying not to make any noise. It's like, yeah, when it's dark, you bump into darkness. And Jesus is saying, if you perceive finances any different than anything that I just taught you, you are actually perceiving in darkness. And you're going to bump into things, and it's not going to work out well for you. Wow. He's also given us a grander vision of how to live our lives and what we can do. And I want to read this last portion. John Nolan, who is another commentary on Matthew, says, the Greek gives us the connotation, listen to this, of a diseased eye. If your perspective of money is to bring you security and provide all your answers, and is best if you store it up here and now, then you're not able to see clearly the way that God has intended you. Wow. So that's what these verses all come together saying. Man, Jesus is saying, listen, change your perspective and how you look at money. Is it important? Yes. Do we need to be good stewards of it? Yes. Do we need to have it so we can live? Yes. But it is not our God, and it is not where our heart and our treasure lies. It lies with God and His commands and His kingdom. Invest in what will outlast. Point number one, earthly investments always fade. Number two, earthly eternal investments will always flourish. Number three, investments always reveal our heart. Number four, in order to invest properly, we need to change our perspective. And then last point, we're all investing in something. What is it going to be? You know, Kraft, J.L. Kraft, you know, Kraft Cheese Corporation, he gave in his life 25% of his income away. Isn't that awesome? He was a Christian. And some of you are thinking, you could have kept some of that to make better cheese. But but he gave all that away. And this is what he said. This is Kraft said this. The only investment I ever made which paid consistently increasing dividends is the money I had given to the Lord. Wow. Look at Matthew 6:24 as we close this morning. No one can serve two masters, for you will hate one or love the other. You'll be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. So Jesus brings the teaching to a head on finances. You see the whole track and how it goes. Not storing up treasures and earth, storing in heaven, wherever your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Change your perspective on giving. See it the way that I'm teaching you. And then he says, ultimately, you cannot serve both God and money. So this morning, as we get ready to watch this closing video, I want to encourage you to examine your own heart and say, and be honest with yourself. It doesn't really matter what I think or anybody else thinks. Only thing that matters is you and God. So where does your treasure lie? Where is your heart? Where are you investing? And I pray that we hear the words of Jesus and say, man, I want to begin to invest in what will truly outlast. Our earthly investments are going to fade. And we have an opportunity to have a grander vision this morning for our lives on this vapor of a life. James says, life is here one moment, and then it's gone. And I've heard many people tell me, life is going pretty fast for me at age 37. Everyone says, oh, wait till you're 60. It goes even faster, right? And if life is that fast, then why not catch a bigger picture, and we're going to invest our lives in what really matters. Invest in what will outlast. You can bow your heads and close your eyes this morning. And before we do anything else, I would be remiss not to give people an opportunity to for the first time cross the line into a relationship with Jesus. And maybe you have been to church before, maybe you know about God, maybe you've talked about God, but maybe you've never had put your faith and trust in Him before as your Lord and Savior. And you'd like to do that this morning. Please agree with me and pray with me in your heart. And God will respond to you right where you are at. Father God, I just thank you that you died on the cross for me. Thank you that you love me. And thank you that you have a way for me to live. And it's for my good that I can trust you. So God, I want to trust you. God, take ownership of my life. I want to follow you. And I put my faith and my trust not in my own efforts, but in your efforts on that cross. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' name, with heads bowed and eyes still closed. If you prayed that prayer online, I encourage you to go ahead and email wyandottefamilychurch.com. wyandottefamilychurch@gmail.com. We would love to follow up with you. But if you prayed that prayer here this morning, with no one looking around, say, yeah, Jeremy, I did pray that prayer for the first time. Just raise your hand. Say, that was me. Please pray for me. If there's anybody here this morning. Thank you. I see that hand. Thank you. Anybody else? Awesome. Very cool. All right, you can go ahead and look up. And for those of you who raised your hand, I want to encourage you to do two quick things that will be very, very helpful for you and for us. Is in the back of your communication card, there's a spot that says, I've crossed the line to relationship with Jesus. Go ahead and mark that down, and then go ahead and take it to the Welcome Center, and we have a free Bible and a CD for you. And because we want to help encourage you and pray for you and follow up with you. And so if you've marked that down, that helps us help you tremendously. Everyone else, I want to challenge you for your next step is going, man, I'm going to evaluate this week where all my investments are going. Are they going internal or temporal? And we're going to take, if you can pull out of your communicator, there is a faith promise form in there. If you can grab that out of your communicator, I just want you to hold that. And, you know, we have an opportunity this morning to give to missions. And all week we've been, you know, meeting missionaries and celebrating what God's doing all over the world. And here's the cool thing is, if you go back to our table and see our missions guide, we support a lot of missionaries. And every time somebody crosses a line to relationship with Jesus in Inner Mongolia, or on the University of Michigan, or, you know, Power Company Kids Club in Detroit, anytime someone's life is turned around in Life Challenge in Detroit, if you're giving to missions, you're a part of that. You're a part of that. Like, it's not just like, oh, well, you know, the missionaries are here and you're down here because, hey, you know, you're only giving. No, if you're praying and you're giving to missions, that is awesome because you are partnering together. And as a team, you're going together and reaching people all over this world for Jesus. And I love what JP talked about. He talked about three types of giving to missions. He said there's safe giving. And safe giving, and maybe that's your next step this morning. Maybe safe giving is going, you know what? $5 a month is safe for me. And I, you know what? I can commit to that. And so I'm going to fill this out. And $5 a month, I'm going to give to missions for this next year. That's great. If that's your next step, that's wonderful. And then the next step beyond that is what's called sacrificial giving. And maybe your next step is, maybe you've always been a safe giver, but a sacrificial giver is going, you know what? I'm going to sacrifice, you know, one Starbucks a week and give so that more people could come to Jesus. That more wells could be dug in Africa. So more, you know, people could be fed in Asia. I want to, you know, that to me, that's more important than the Starbucks. That's called sacrificial giving because you're now sacrificing something so you can give. So you have safe giving, which is wonderful. You have sacrificial giving. If that's you, that's your next step. That's wonderful. And then we have supernatural giving. You say, what's that? Well, that's when God goes, give this much every month. And you're like, what? Get thee behind me, Satan. And then you try to stuff it down, and all of a sudden it keeps coming up, and it keeps coming up, and it keeps coming up. And what God is leading you to, He's leading you into the deep of the ocean, to where now you're not on the shore anymore, to where now you're going, God, I have to trust in you. And I tell you what, is there's been several times where we have given way more than we should have been given in our lives, to where our tax return people are going, this doesn't add up. I'm like, hey, talk to him, right? Because it's his fault. But we were blessed that God took care of us and God provided and God, and we didn't go without, and we had so much joy knowing that we had partnered. So our job isn't to pressure you. Our job isn't to guilt you. Our job is to challenge you to take your next step in one of those categories, whatever it is. And so I'm going to pray. And I just want to ask if you could grab that and hold that in your hand and just have an open heart and say, God, speak to me what my next step is. And then do it. And you will never regret doing what God has asked you to do. And think about what we can do as a church if everybody does something. How many missionaries we can support and add, and how many lives are going to be changed. I'm so excited just to get the results of what God's going to do. So God, we hold our mission's faith promise in our hands. And God, I thank you that you love people, that you are willing to be the first missionary. You are willing to send your son Jesus out of heaven into our world to become one of us, to talk our language, to engage with us, to God experiencing everything that we do, and yet so you could die on the cross and provide hope and healing and forgiveness. And now, God, you're asking us to do the same. Lord, and so, God, some people pray for missionaries, some people give, and some people go, Father, and you're calling all of us to take our next step. And so I pray, God, that you would speak to us, whatever you want us to do, God, safe giving, sacrificial giving, or supernatural giving. Lord, I pray in this moment, Holy Spirit, you would speak to our hearts. God, we just heard a message about what really matters, God, and we don't want to live our lives for the junkyard. We don't want to spend our days spinning our wheels so at the end of our lives, 40 years after we're gone, majority of our stuff is in the dump. God, we want to invest in eternity. God, we want souls to be added to the kingdom. We want to get to heaven, and we want to see thousands of people in heaven because of Wyandotte Family Church. God, because we gave, because we prayed, because we sacrificed. God, I pray you would birth vision into our hearts. God, speak to me, speak to our staff, speak to our leadership. God, speak to Mike and Lisa, our missions directors. Speak to every single one of us, God, and take us deeper in you, Lord God, and that we could lead, at the end of this year, we could look back and be amazed at what you have done and your faithfulness. We thank you for it, God, and we praise your awesome name. And so we just, God, by faith, we're going to obey what you say. In Jesus' name. Amen.